A Time for Change, Chapter 6, After School Drama. Amari wake up way before her alarm on her first day of school in Raleigh. She could barely bring herself to eat the toast with butter and cinnamon sugar her mother had made for her. I feel sick to my stomach, Mom. Do I have to go today? Maybe I could just start school in September since there's only one term of the year left anyway, Amari pleaded. I know you are feeling incredibly nervous, love. That's perfectly normal. In fact, it would be strange for you to not be worried. But you'll get through the day, one class at a time, just like at Charles Taylor. Mrs. Johnson grabbed Amari's book bag and lunch and walked her down the path to the end of their street. They had done a trial run earlier in the week, so Amari would know exactly where she was going. It only took 12 minutes to walk to Battery Heights High School. Approaching the steps of the school, Amari could feel acid rising in her throat. She knew no one, not a soul. Every day back home, she and Jackie walked to school, elementary, junior high, and high school, together. Unless Jackie was sick, Amari never had to show up alone. She timidly climbed the stairs, ignoring the many unfamiliar sets of eyes staring at her. The wooden entry doors seemed enormous and heavy as she pulled their handles. Glancing down the main hallway, she saw groups of kids in the distance. Some were tough-looking, decked out in boots and leather jackets, but like every high school in America, there were also stunningly beautiful girls chatting by the lockers. Amari headed for the school's main office since she didn't have her schedule yet. The secretary handed her a piece of paper and told her the number of her homeroom, 312A. Her school in Monopon had three floors, which meant it was compact and easy to navigate. Spanning an entire city block, Battery Heights High School seemed mammoth in comparison. Like her new house, it was a ranch-style building. Amari guessed that was one way to beat the heat. No school for black kids was going to have air conditioning when the weather got hot. The first bell rang, making her jump, and suddenly loads of students dashed past her. She was still looking for her classroom, but no one stopped to ask if she needed help. The second bell rang. Darn, I'm late, Amari muttered under her breath. A couple of minutes later, she found 312A. The homeroom teacher, Mrs. James, found Amari an unoccupied seat, then accompanied her to her first period class. The first four classes all blended together. Each teacher had Amari introduce herself, which was mortifying in her opinion, before giving her a textbook. Amari thought some of the books were in even worse shape than the ones back home, something she would have thought was impossible. But being the new kid, she said nothing. At lunch, Amari sat at a table in the back of the cafeteria, hoping to stay under the radar and not attract attention. She ate her peanut butter sandwich and chocolate chip cookies as fast as she could, staring down at the table. She didn't want to make it even more obvious that she had no friends. The homework load seemed lighter than in Boston, which was nice, but some classes had more behavior problems. Kids shouting out in class instead of raising their hands, others throwing spitballs and passing notes. Amari found it hard to concentrate. When the 2 o'clock bell rang, Amari could not wait to leave, but she decided to hold back for a couple of minutes before packing up her bag for the night. That way, she figured at least some of the after-school chaos would settle down a bit. When Amari finally started walking home, the sidewalks looked crowded, full of strangers. So she decided to try an alternative route that might have fewer people on it. A couple of blocks down, a group of white kids stood outside a corner store. She heard some hooting and hollering, but didn't think much about it. Then, out of sheer curiosity, Amari quickly glanced to see what the fuss was about. "Hey girl, what are you doing on our turf?" one boy said. "No black kids getting cream sodas in here. Go back to your part of town." Amari immediately looked to the ground and started walking faster. Unfortunately, some of the kids started trailing her. She ran as fast as she could with her heavy school bag on her back, but the boys chased her for a couple of blocks. She could feel the leather straps of her bursting at the seams book bag digging into her shoulders, but she didn't dare slow down. Finally, panting and sweating, she turned the corner into her neighborhood and was alone. She burst through the front door like a hurricane. Tears streamed from her eyes. "What happened, Amari?" Mrs. Johnson looked stunned. "Why are you crying?" Amari tried to catch her breath, her chest still heaving from the sprinting. Sobbing, she mumbled, They chased me home. They said to go back to my part of town. Who said that? Who chased you, baby? Amari's mom was livid. Amari told her mother about her rotten day from start to finish. When she was done and the tears had stopped, she asked if she could call Jackie. Yes, Amari. Just remember, is it a long-distance call and expensive, so you'll have to keep it relatively short, okay? Amari felt much better after her conversation with Jackie. She knew she would. Jackie was delighted to hear her best friend's familiar voice and to hear all about Amari's new house and school. She suggested that Amari reach out to some of the quieter kids in her classes. Then maybe she could find people to sit with lunch at and also to walk home with. Before hanging up, Jackie promised to write a letter that weekend, and so did Amari. Amari headed to her bedroom, looking much nicer with the new bulletin board she'd filled with photos of Matapan, her old house, ribbons from a dance she'd attended, and a colorful bookmark Jackie had painted her the previous year in art class. With her bed covered in a new lilac bedspread, the room seemed cheerful and full of promise, even if Amari herself wasn't feeling that way. After doing some math and English homework, Amari clicked on the transistor radio she'd gotten for Christmas. The announcer reported that the sit-ins in Greensboro were still going on. She was fascinated by the interviews of some of the students who had participated in the sit-ins. One said a white man had dumped ketchup on his head, while another said white folks had spit at her. Many had racial insults shouted in their faces, and yet they all remained committed to the nonviolent methods of protest. Amari was stunned at these students' ability to remain calm even in the face of such hostility. The male and female students just waited and waited to be served at the Woolworth's lunch counter. Some studied at the counter as a way to pass the time productively. But every day, they continued their work toward racial equality. As an NAACP representative said, "These young people, tomorrow's leaders, are seeking much more than the opportunity to eat where and as others eat in public places. They seek self-respect, recognition, and dignity." In the next segment of the radio broadcast, Amari heard that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. would be coming to meet with student activists at Shaw University. She had read the heaps of articles in the newspapers about Dr. King's work in cities around the nation. In her elementary school social studies class, Amari studied Dr. King's work with the bus boycott in Montgomery, Alabama. She also saw a television program about the Southern Christian Leadership Conference and their work to get Black voters registered in the South. Amari imagined getting the chance to hear Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. speak. She marveled at what a great public speaker he was. Her mother often talked about how much wonderful work Dr. King was doing for Black people all over the United States. Suddenly, Amari's attention shifted when she heard her father's deep voice in the hallway. "Amari, dinner is ready," he called. She switched off her radio and headed to the dining room. Over dinner, Amari told her dad about the rough day she'd had at school. "The first day is always tough," he said. "It's bound to get better, Amari." Amari nodded. He was probably right. But she definitely would not make the same mistake of using a different route home. Changing the topic, she begged, "Daddy, do you think we can see Dr. King when he comes to Shaw? You teach there, so I'm sure you can go." Her dad smiled. "Hold up, little lady. I hadn't heard about Dr. King coming to Shaw. Remember, I'm in the medical school part of campus and have not finished reading today's paper yet." He took his glasses off and looked like he was thinking. "I just started this job, Amari, so don't be too sure about anything. Dr. King is going to be extremely busy with the students. I'll see what I can do, but I can't make any promises." "All right, Daddy, I understand, but I really hope we can see him," she said.